life. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Ross Patterson Revolution! Brought to you by GhostBed.com.
We did it. We did it. Jamie, grab me a book real quick here. I'm in shock today. I don't have my wits about me. A lot of feelings, a lot of emotions going on.
I can catch it, Jamie. I can catch it.
A lot of emotions going on. I'm going to hold it up to camera to everybody who's watching the YouTube show. Thank you for my service. Made the New York Times bestseller list.
By the skinnier balls.
But Americano. Actually, no.
Oh, no. Every other list, you're number one. I'm saying New York Times. They really had to sit there and be like, man, this
do
is
we
number
want
one.
This guy.
How do we want to fuck this up? No, but not really.
I wonder what the discussion was. So for everybody at home who's been supporting us all along the way and bought copies of the book, copies of it.
You've done it.
You bought copies. You went out to the stores. You did it. And we were actually the highest selling book in all the world. It was actually number one in the world. So to our surprise, we were number one on Washington
Post.
No, I'm sorry. Yeah, not the Post. Wall Street Journal. Wall Street Journal bestseller, USA Today, Publishers Weekly. And then we get the New York Times bestseller list and we're actually number five. And I was like, man, I wonder, did we get beat? And
because
by the way,
your first thought is because you just think of the New York Times as just, well, nobody that listens to this show thinks that. But I still had a little sliver of like, no, it's not real. They just look at the numbers.
Yeah.
They're not biased. They're not going to, you know, put a conservative book down the list just because they want to. They wouldn't do that, right?
And they did.
And they did do that. And so, listen, we live in that world. That's just what it is.
Right. And I will say this, the actual numbers came out on Publishers Weekly. They started doing this. So if you want to go check it for yourself, you guys can.
Are you kidding me?
It was amazing. So
everyone did exactly what they needed to do. And they got those motherfuckers. I can just see their faces. The little New York Times
people,
dweebs.
Yeah.
Dorks. Later, nerd. You're not coming to Olive Garden, that's for sure, because you're a nerd and nobody likes you. But anyways, those nerds.
Yeah.
Dweebs.
Yep.
Dork patrols got into a room and they said, gosh, now this is the one that sold the most. But guys, not a good look, right?
Yeah.
And I really personally liked Michelle Obama's book.
Yeah.
And so I think I'm going to put that first.
And that's actually what happened. So Michelle Obama came in at number two on that. And when we got the numbers, hardback wise, because this is what the category is on all of these lists is hardbacks, because that's, you know, opening week, they're worth the most and they sell for the most. You know, hardback's expensive, man.
Yeah.
Like $25 or $26.
That's a big ask.
It
to
is.
To ask people to shell out. Even if I love a Burke, not a big reader, but.
Yeah.
Even if I love a Burke, I look on the back and, you know, you're like, dang, okay. Could I get this cheaper somewhere? Can I wait for paperback?
Yeah.
So it's a really big ask and it's a big deal
to
buy the, you know, hardcover for that price. And
for any book. And based on the numbers, so number one, we were number one in the world actually with 26,000 hard copies sold in the first week. Number two was Educated, which is actually a great book. It's been on the New York Times bestseller list for like 76 weeks. They sold 20,000 copies. We sold 6,000 more than them hardback wise. Michelle Obama was like fifth or sixth. She only sold 8,200 copies, yet she was number two on the New York Times bestseller list, which is so odd to me.
It's so crazy that it doesn't make it irrelevant, you know, where like even when you find out that really that list is what those people in the room feel like they want to put up there, we still think of it as the end all be all, right?
Yeah.
The list.
Yeah,
they
yeah, yeah.
must know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They must know what everyone is. And they just put the most amount at the top.
That's what I thought. That's what I thought.
That's what you thought. And then you find out that's not true. And does it take away from it? No.
No, not at all.
It's still the fact that they had to reckon with that.
Yeah.
To me, makes me like go like, fuck you, you know, that you sold so many. Because listen, if it was just enough to get on the list, we now know it probably wouldn't have gotten there, right? If it was just 8,000, if it was just 5,000 or whatever it is, it wouldn't have gotten there. We now know that you guys killed it. You sold so many that they literally dweeb, dork patrol, nerd, once again, all of the not cool. We're not going to, they don't get to hang out with us. But anyway, all of them had to actually say like, fuck, we have to put this book somewhere.
Yeah, we got to put it on the list.
We don't want to.
Because when the numbers come
out. Don't even know who this fucking guy is, but we do not want to put it up there.
When the numbers come out, you know, on Publishers Weekly, they drop Friday, so they drop today because we're actually recording this today. So we're going to Olive Garden tonight. Jesse Americano. Jesse really did rent out the private room at the Olive Garden, so we are going to do that tonight, and that'll be hilarious. You'll have to check our Instagram for videos for that, at Jesse Wiseman,
night.
Or at ST James for a real Italian night for a taste of Italy.
I'll have to boomerang some breadsticks for you guys.
Yeah.
I'll just boomerang with everyone, with all the girls. And they'll be like,
Yeah, but that it is. It's such an amazing accomplishment and achievement. And it's one of those things where, again, plane goes down. I said this on another episode. Plane goes down. I die. You know, well, flight flying out of Charlotte crashed. With a New York Times bestseller on board. Yeah. Best-selling author died in this crash. How tragic.
Beautiful wife, now single at home, is what they'll also.
She will never meet someone talented enough to write a New York Times best-selling book, but good on her for trying to move on with her life.
And here's her number.
Yeah.
If anyone.
The kids will probably grow up clutching their dead father's book because...
But good luck, brother.
Whoever she remarried was just
okay,
such a
loser. Okay, now is this all in the article?
Probably.
Okay, yeah.
I would probably say it's in the article for sure. I would definitely say it's in the article for sure. But here's
just
the...
Just like, this article really
this
went
is a
off the
strange
rails.
Article.
Like,
and it just
normal,
it just
like,
keeps
about
going.
A plane
yeah.
crash.
Yeah.
And then it slowly turns into... How the wife won't be able to move on.
Yeah, the wife, the wife and the new husband drove down to Disneyland. The kids didn't want to get out. They said they'd rather stay in the car and cry and read their father's bestseller,
New York Times
best-selling book, rather than go into Disney World and see all their faves. That's probably what it'll say. I mean, that's just a guess.
Right.
But it is all of that and more. And there was a time. Like a good few hours where, you know, it didn't really set in. I would say it didn't, you know, kick in till the next day. Because you have these dreams in life where you imagine yourself doing something, right? No matter what it is. My first one was doing stand-up for the first time, you know? And, like, to me, that was a big deal at the time. Then you realize after you do it a million times, you're like, it'd be great to have a special or something like that, right? Your dreams get bigger. Mm-hmm. I knew pretty quickly on in my life that I wanted to be an actor. And when I ended up doing The New Guy, it wasn't until I actually got to sit in a theater with real people and see it on opening day that it really clicked into me. Like even the premiere and stuff the week before and all that stuff. And you know, granted, I went on to do 30 movies or whatever after that. But that first one was just like, oh man, I can't believe this is really happening because you've dreamed about it for so long. This... I actually didn't know if it was achievable, to be honest with you, in my life, just because of what we went through on the last one, where numbers wise, it made it. Even with the ban on Amazon, we had enough copies sold that it probably would have entered if they would have went by just real numbers
just
on the New York Times. Just by numbers, just real numbers, like everyone else should. It would have entered the charts at number 8 or 9 in the world that week, and it didn't. So it was like, and I remember waking up and trying to find the numbers and do all that shit and like, you know, wasn't on there. And then I'm talking about when darkness falls, he doesn't catch it. And I was like, fuck, all right, maybe this isn't a, a dream that's achievable, you know? If it's a curated list, which the New York Times bestseller is, and it says that in very, very fine print when you go through their website.
But I would think that that is more for if there's a couple different books that sell the same, around the same amount, like 8,000, 5,000. Mm-hmm. I would think that curated footnote is for that. Like, listen, if you did sell enough, like, there's only so many we could put at the lower 15 or whatever, right?
Right. And
it's not for if you sell more than everyone on this list, we're still not going to.
Yeah, yeah, still not going to do it. But even, look, because it goes 1 through 15 on there on the New York Times bestseller list. And so even with When Darkness Falls, like, that would have hit 8 or 9. Mm-hmm. You're still making the top 10. I don't know how you justify
right.
that not being there or whatever. And so I kind of, truthfully, in my mind at that point, almost dismissed it, where I was just like, all right, the one thing that I thought we had going for us with this was they're not going to do it to a military veteran.
Right.
They're not going to not report the honest numbers for a military veteran. That would be super fucked up, right?
Super fucked up, you'd think.
You would think.
You would think.
And then, you know, because Matt got the call first, and then he called me and was just like, hey, man, we got the number. And I thought it was going to be like, oh, 2 or something like that, you know? And it was 5. And I was like, huh? Mm. And I looked
it's
at the...
where they felt comfortable putting...
Matt. Yeah.
Matt.
And Amazon 5. Started doing their own charts as well. Mm-hmm. This just started this year because, look, 90% of your sales are coming off of Amazon these days. On Amazon, and it's like you can go to the website, we were number 2. We finished number 2 on the charts in the world. The only reason we weren't number 1 was the book ahead of us had paperback versions available. So,
right.
you know, obviously a lot of people purchase paperback
absolutely.
And it's cheaper and all
no
that stuff.
Qualms.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So, yeah, we probably would have been number 1 on that. But that was a fair rating. Like, hey, we didn't have the other things mm-hmm. out that they did. So that was a fair rating. And then the rest of them, USA Today was fair and Wall Street Journal and Publishers Weekly. And that was fair. And then the New York Times one, it's just weird to me. You know, they're supposed to be an esteemed newspaper that everybody depends on, or mm-hmm. what is it, their slogan is like democracy first or some bullshit like that. And it's like, hey man,
I don't even know what their slogan is anymore. It's
I don't
so
either.
All over the place. Like,
I don't either. And here's
I took the daily off my phone.
Here's the scary thing, by the way, is it's doing really, really well this week. Does it stay on the list for another week?
We'll see. I mean, they could make up for it. They're still not going to be able to hang out with
what
us.
If they put it number 1 next week? What if they were like, hey, man, we
would
fucked this up
them?
And got it
no.
wrong. I would if you looked back on it and said, hey, we did a little more research.
Don't bother New York Times. This. You know, the really thing is like, don't bother.
No. Do bother because
don't,
number one really, really
he
helps.
He doesn't care about it.
Sales.
He doesn't care about
I
it.
Do definitely care.
I don't care about it. You know, the only thing we care about is the people that got the book. They're loving it.
Yes.
They came out. They don't care, by the way, if you're number one. They are reading the book and they bought it because they like you guys and they wanted to read a book that's going to speak to more of how they felt about their military experience.
They did, but they also look all the I would say 80% of the messages we got were like, hey, we want you guys to be number one. This is what we want to do. How can we help?
Like I said, they don't care. I don't care. You know, you don't care. New York Times, you know.
You bet. Again, still care. Need that sticker on the book. So that would be rad if they want to give a nice little makesies upsies for it. But truly, I am from the bottom of my heart grateful to all of you guys for this. That is a massive, unbelievable life achievement. And it, you know, I was telling you earlier, this morning when we got up, it almost feels like a weight off my back of like, you want to do something that is considered important in this life, not only for myself and my own personal goals, but for your kids, mm-hmm. where they'll be able to go walk around through life of what does your dad do mm-hmm. and say, well, my dad was a New York Times bestselling author. And that's a pretty big stamp to have on life where you're like, man, that is an unbelievable accomplishment.
And then you go, they go, what does your mom do?
Yep. And she's
still like, just still trying to figure it out, yeah. you know?
Papa Americano.
She might take some classes at JC, you know?
Yeah.
Just figure it out.
Pop,
you know?
on down to a nice JC, Cape Fear Community
like still
College.
Figuring it out.
Yeah. Take an art class, take a photography class, you know?
Yeah.
Put a dark room in the basement.
There you go. I might like start taking pictures.
With old vintage cameras. That would be the most Gwyneth Paltrow thing that Gwyneth Paltrow has never done.
Maybe I'll start a blog.
Yeah.
A blog.
But yeah, I there was a point at a loss for words where I was just like, man, I did it. We fucking did it. And it is solely because of you guys. And a pretty fucking cool moment in life, to be totally real with you. I'm definitely not cooler than recognizing how big that this moment is, where you're just like, holy shit, that's awesome. And to me personally, at this point with everything I've done, because I feel like we are kind of living out our dreams with, you know, writing books and doing podcasts and shit for a living, making movies. And it's like, man, somebody asked me what's left. There's only one thing that I would really like to do, and I, you know, we'll see if that happens or not, is turn the St. James books into a series for HBO, and that's it. I would check off life after that.
Yeah.
Like, every other dream would have been accomplished at that point. The Oscars was never a thing for me. You know, not a Grammy, although, let's face it, I Am All Harambe probably deserves, We Are All Harambe.
Right.
Probably deserved a Grammy, but that wasn't a thing or anything else. So that's pretty much it for me in this life. And then you can go and be with Kurt Russell and live happily ever after that.